next speaker, which is Adam Peckin from the CER, that is the Community of European Railway and Infrastructure Companies. And there he is head of the Economic Policy and Sustainability Group. So please, Adam, the microphone is yours.
Yes, good morning, everyone. It's very nice to be here this morning to speak after the Commission to present some views from the railway sector. So as you know, CER is representing the railway businesses. So we represent both the operators and the infrastructure managers. And I'm indeed dealing with the economic and environmental topics for CER for some time. And rail noise is one important topic that we address. It's a priority for railways to reduce the noise. So my presentation will focus a bit on the policy, but of course I would like to deal a bit more detailed position views and encourage a discussion on the economics behind it to make that rail is reducing noise, but also offering its services for the society in a good way. So if I can have my presentation, I will go through it with you. So as you see, the title is Towards Quieter Railways, which is, as I say, an important point, and rail is taking many actions. If we go to the next one, it's really to build on what both Nino and Marco really correctly say, and I guess we will see a bit more from the European Environment Agency, but we have to acknowledge that noise is really the second largest health problem in Europe. And this is, of course, coming after the air pollution, which rail is also a very good tool. We don't need to say that rail's role in greenhouse gas reduction efforts, but noise remains there really an important problem. And we speak about millions of European citizens affected by it. Of course, it can go beyond. I'm not myself really the noise specialist here with education, but of course I'm dealing with it, but I'm really reading that it also impacts the nature and wildlife. So it's again, important thing for railways to address it appropriately because our infrastructure is also passing by as part of the transport infrastructure. And what we have to see that noise is really a challenge there because there's the trends we have to look. And I have spent a couple of days to dig into the staff working document that's supplemented the European strategy. So Nino showed you all the milestones, the main headlines of the strategy. I have dealt a lot with the over 200 page long document to look at what it really means. And currently CR Economic Group is taking the time to comment on the study based on facts and figures, of course. And there we really see urbanization, which matters a lot for transport networks and transport operations, that we will have a EU which will be much more populated in cities. So urbanization is something we have to watch out. There are many good things for decarbonization of transport. Rail is, of course, there in the core. We saw all the important milestones that builds on the transport white papers of the past and this mobility strategy did is there. And there's also development on the other modes, which need to really recap. And electric cars, trucks, they are developing and they are more on streets. It's good for climate and air pollution. Probably also good at the same time for noise because you don't have the noisy engines with ICE. But it's also bad because you have more heavy vehicles with batteries and also there is still the friction that comes from the tires and the road surfaces. So there, Marco was already saying the labels of tires, but nevertheless, the problem will not be solved with a magic touch of electrification of vehicles, because there we already have the more efficient rail system, steel on steel connection, but still we have to address the noise, as I said. And rest point, of course, aviation traffic. When we look at the staff document, that we see more than 100% growth towards 2050, the aviation, despite COVID pandemic these days, is likely to continue and take much more passengers and freight also in the sky, according to the baseline performed. If you go to the next slide, please, is just to remind you that For us, the climate neutrality of the EU Green Deal is very important, and that is really built on the model shift to rail. We know our credentials, of course, and rail needs to be used much more where it makes sense, and it needs then to be competitive terms and be at the same time attractive to the users, both the passengers and the shippers. So overall, this can bring a real value to the society. And that regard, rail needs to be silent, because then you will be overcoming all the problems you see for building infrastructure, making it modern, increasing the capacity, and also running more trains on it, which we really need to achieve the Green Deal and the strategy that was addressed this morning. So next slide, please. Here, I'm bringing you an important aspect, and there I think I will gradually take you to the economics behind and the pricing aspects of addressing noise. And there it's about the external cost. So here the graph you see on your screen is the data from the European Commission study on the external cost and the infrastructure. So that was a big study which was performed a year ago. And it was really an important update on the values of individual externalities. It's being performed by the recent publication of the Mobility Atlas, which is presenting it. And there, I would, of course, can really say that we speak about more than 550 billion amount of externalities. So this is a huge amount that EU citizens are paying. We have there, of course, on this picture, congestion excluded. So just to give you very briefly, without detailing it, that there is really a huge amount of money being spent by the citizens because of a market failure there. Of course, there are big issues you see on the chart that comes from the road sector that is really causing problems. But of course, we may go and zoom in to rail, which is today's topic. And there we still have the noise cost of EU on the total transport side, 60 billion, and rail is still causing it. Although rail's total externalities are very low, but noise, this noise problem needs to really be addressed. And then we have, of course, the topic of the regulations and the measures that are taking place. So this is the TSI noise at source, which with the retrofitting are really the important initiatives, and they are to address this noise cost of railways. But we really need in this frame really a big picture as possible. So that's why I want to take a little bit time on this overall graph, because as you may see on the noise side, there's nothing much you see on aviation. But as I said, the increasing in the aviation figures in the last decades and the projection I mentioned you towards the 2050 is really huge. And we have already seen, and this is from the staff working document, that compared to 2005, we have seen a plus 12% increase of citizens that are exposed to air traffic noise. So this is an important thing, and the picture should be really complete. And at the same time, again, with this report of the Commission, it's really mentioning at the same level of exposure, aviation noise is much more annoying than rail and road noise. So we have to really put in place what more actions we take towards the noise and also means to achieve that. And so that overall noise, the total noise from transport is minimized, and we have the protection of health of citizens. So please, if we go to the next slide, is just to build on our activities on making rail quieter. This is happening by the time we speak, and that's a good thing, I think, and we should be maybe proud of it, is that we have the electric trains that are already running many passengers. And if this is happening on a well-maintained infrastructure, we really then have really not a big problem. the noise limits are matched and no annoyance really is caused. But then if you look at especially the older freight wagons, which are of course much heavier with the goods they transport, and they are equipped with the cast iron brake blocks. And there we have the noise issue. And then at the main nighttime, more citizens are exposed to this. And that needs really to be addressed. And that is why we have the TSI noise recently revision with the implementation of quieter routes. We in 3 years time, we will see this being started to be implemented. And there we will be really seeing an important aspect, and that target that is already being set is also giving an indication to the sector to retrofit and to also plan their fleet renewals so that we have the reduction of noise. And that is, as I said, much more smooth and easy than compared to the road fleet renewal, which of course happens much quicker. Their fleet is not being used for decades. But of course, there the noise issue needs to be really more carefully assessed, because especially if you run all those heavier electric trucks. Of course, and that I really like from Marco's final points, that safety is very important, and that's also no compromise. We should even put it more on top than the profitability of the sector, because any accident will be really very bad. And there, Nordic winter conditions, as underlined by Nino, is a topic that is currently being addressed, and hopefully that will be tackled with proper solutions in this process. And last point I would like to say here is that we have, of course, the EU Green Deal, and our members and CR is, of course, promoting, and that is reflected in the UIC collaboration that we have, is based on voluntary targets. We are for zero emission transport, and there is, of course, the electrification. That's very key, and there is a gradual phasing up the diesel propulsion. And there it will also contribute to the noise mitigation. If we go to the next slide, that I would like to convey the message that sector has really done its fair share. It's continuing to do so. We already see this good number of more than 200,000 wagons retrofitted, thanks to also EU funds and national initiatives and sector's motivation. But we still have more to go. I put here a number maybe to initiate a discussion. Some may say this is too much, but definitely 100 more will not help us. So I really say that we need 200,000 wagons to go, so that this also includes all the difficult wagons that exist in the national level, so that rail freight noise is no longer a problem. And then, of course, this has to be addressed with the proper funding frames. And there we have the EU co-funding, the CEF. We hope to see how this needs to come in the new budget of the EU, and also the national subsidies. So far, they were really very much limited. And then we have also the noise charges. They were very much limited by member states. We, of course, saw recently a Czech system in 2020 that complemented the Dutch, the German, and the Swiss, and the Austrians, but it's very limited in numbers. And there we have to see how DG MOVE assessment comes. And the rest, we speak about 16% more operating costs that is already borne by the sector, especially for the first mover companies. There, I have two other points to tell you, of course, and that is the things that with our experts we try to address, and that is the noise performance of composite brake blocks, so the new blocks. So we have now all the measures in place, but we should be sure that they comply, because the market will develop, as I said here, 200,000 wagons to go, that we should be really sure that the end result is good for noise reduction. And then also the park trains is a subject that may be studied by the sector, and that will be, I think, important point for us in the next periods. So if we go and continue with the presentation, next slide, is that retrofitting, I think, really remains an economic topic because technology is not that new. It's there. Of course, there are issues like the winter conditions to be addressed. We have now the policy set, there are goals, but financial incentives are really required so that we have the speedy completion of the retrofitting, this 200 more wagons that I mentioned. And there's good news. We have some funding tools, and I may even say we can be innovative or creative in combining all those things. Noise differentiated track access charges, which as an economist I like, of course, although not many member states really implement them, is a really way of having the polluter pay, user pay principle in practice. Of course, there we have to link it to the other modes so that this is really being a real tool to correct the market failure and protect rail's competitiveness. But this is one tool, of course, the bonuses at this stage we can speak about. And then the CEF budget, the new EU budget should really bring these fundings. And of course, again, like 2 years ago, my plea will be to more having higher co-funding, that is key, and bigger budgets and more flexible in terms. Then state aid guidelines, which are to be revised, is a proper tool for member states to make use of money to complement rail needs. And then we have now with the COVID, the new tool, recovery and resilience facility, is of course not for the very short term goals, but it will be an important funding to have this recovery that can really bring also protection on noise. If we go a bit beyond the regular things we speak, and there's the EU sustainable finance agenda. Then we speak about the financing that comes from private money, but the EU is already with the taxonomy defining sector, which are green, and rail is part of this, of course, and we would, of course, make use of this, and there's already a case from Italy to have the wagon renewal, which can really be an example. Once you have this business cases and you make use of private money, taxonomy and the sustainable finance, so through green bonds, that can be an interesting exercise. Again, if we link the noise charges with the road pricing, Eurovignette is the directive applicable to road trucks and currently being discussed by the policy institutions. Although the topic is very complex and it's a road topic, but because of the intermodal aspect, CR is part of the debate. And there will be possibilities and also for the charging on noise, but also to use of revenues to further reduce transport emissions. But to be honest, that's very difficult to achieve. And then we also have the EU emission trading system. And there we speak about electric transportation, wider electric transportation and the carbon price, which is now towards 40 euro per ton of CO2, of course, is bringing currently to the member states a big amount of money. There's going to be a discussion about own resource for the EU. And of course, all these aspects, Eurovignette and ETS, can really mean revenue recycling. So bringing back to the areas that needs improvements, and in this case, noise mitigation. So this is a list I wanted to share for your reflections after the session or during the coffee break. And maybe we can go to the next slide. And that will be my final slide. And that is about the proposals for a cost-competitive quieter rail. So here, I don't want to start with the euro value there. That's the check we may receive, of course, but that is maybe to conclude. But we can have some different timeline. Start with the short term. We have the period towards the quieter routes from today. I think it's best to continue with the noise charges where it exists. Then we have, of course, the CEF budget with a co-funding rate that can be higher than the existing 20%, and then state aids to support all those first movers. Then we go midterm focus with the recovery and resilience facility, make best of it, implement as much as possible the polluter pay principle for all modes. So rail is their address, of course, with all these measures, but don't forget aviation and road. And then the ETS revenues, as I said, can be really interesting thing for the electric rail to benefit a bit more and make also this switch from the diesel tractions. And then for the longer term, 2030 onwards, we can really then go towards the private money, for example, more green bonds, more vegan renewables. And then, of course, with all the model shift that can really happen in that period with the EU strategy, we can have more revenue, more self-sufficient business. And there, of course, it will mean we are carrying much flow of these freight on rail. And of course, noise is mitigated. I have here put 100 million euro, just again, for reflection. And that can be really some kind of an annual budget that can be really available to access and to have this reduction more on the short run. Thank you for your interest. I also have my details there. It's pity that we will not be able to have the face-to-face coffee in person, but I look forward to having interactions with you.
Okay, thank you very much, Etam, for your very interesting talk.